Hey, BCH 341 students. I'm Professor Jeff Yarger. I want to spend some time going through an example problem, one that is directly out of your homework and comes out of the primary book we've been using for the spring 2018 course, which is Biophysical Chemistry by James Allen. So in chapter two, he goes through a problem, number nine, where we are looking at dry ice and what happens to it if you kept it in a closed container and allowed it to sublime. And so I've given the exact problem that is in the book here. And I've also, the back of the book has solutions directly in it. And so I've given you the solution they give explicitly. What I'm here to do today in this screencast is to kind of go through, walk you through some of the nuances of this to make sure we fully understand it from a conceptual level as well as working the problem level. So we have five. I always like to work problems where I make it as visual as possible. A lot of us are fairly visual learners. And so I tend to, you know, do something like imagine that I have a container and this container is, you know, 30 milliliters in total volume, you know, and it says that it's sealed, you know, so basically, you know, this is in a fixed volume container, right? And so we have, you know, 5 grams of dry ice, which is CO2 in the solid state, right? And we put it in there, we seal this up, and we ask, you know, in a sense, it's asking, what's the final state of this? And so what it's expecting you to know, and it's telling you something about is that dry ice, given the name, it's sublime. So at room temperature, it goes directly from a solid into the gaseous state. So this thing is going to go from 5 grams of solid to CO2 in the gas state here. And what it's asking you to figure out is a very practical thing, which is if we did this in practice, you know, what kind of pressure are we going to generate in this container? You know, and is that container going to be able to hold that pressure, right? So this is, in a sense, has a very practical sense to it. Now, the solution in the back of the book says, anytime you start looking at gas problems, the first thing we think of is the ideal gas equation. And so it's always a good place to start. And when you start there, you can see that if you look at this 5 grams of CO2, that, you know, if you divide through by its molecular weight, which is 44 grams per mole, then that gives you the overall number of moles of CO2 in that 5 gram quantity, right? So that's where this comes from, because you need the number of moles, you need the gas constant, which is given here, right? Now, it doesn't say anything about temperature at all in this problem, but we almost assume when we're thinking of practical problems, room temperature, and you can tell from the solution that's what they assume. So, but you have to almost state that it's an assumption that we're figuring this out for room temperature or standard temperature in a sense, which is 25 degrees Celsius or 298 degrees Kelvin, right? And then we have something that's 30 milliliters, which is 0.03 liters, so that all the units work out for this version of R, right? And when you do that, you calculate a pressure of 92.63 atmospheres. Now, this is why we're working a lot of this problem, is to get some intuition. The first thing you should realize, we're at 1 atmosphere pressure, right? And all it takes is a few atmospheres of pressure, and it gets pretty extreme fairly fast. 92 atmospheres is a lot of pressure for a container to be able to hold. You should convert that maybe to pressure units you might be more familiar with, like PSI, pounds per square inch or something, whatever gives you a good intuition for this. Chemists often work in bars or atmospheres. And so this is a significantly high pressure. In fact, it's high enough that the first thing that comes to my mind is that this is not going to act ideally at all. And how can we test that, in a sense, the assumption that was made by working this problem that it's an ideal gas, we can move to an equation of state, which is what the ideal gas law is. It's telling you something about how the system behaves in the pressure volume mechanical work sense. And we can look at one that takes into account non-ideal conditions. And the one that we almost always go to in chemistry is the van der Waal, and it's usually just VDW for short, van der Waal equation of state. And usually that's capital E, small os, so a lot of different terminologies. You can, again, a really good example of this is on Wikipedia, has really good description of van der Waal gases, the van der Waal constants for a whole series of stuff, etc. The gas constant itself in a bunch of different units. This is really a good resource to look up a lot about this problem. Now, the van der Waals, you can see, it looks similar. And, you know, this is paraphrasing from your book, like the first part here is taking into account the assumption that an ideal gas, the volume, you know, the atoms themselves or the molecules or the number of moles of whatever it is, doesn't per se take up any real volume. It's infinitely compressible, as we would say. And this makes a correction for that, that it assumes these are hard spheres, and therefore you're going to hit a compressibility limit of these things. And so oftentimes when you just look at this part of the equation, it's even called, you know, a hard sphere gas or a hard sphere equation of state. And sometimes that's used all by itself just to correct that one misconception that molecules really do take up space. The other one is correcting for the idea that when you get molecules closer and closer together or more dense as you go, as you increase the molar volume, that they can either attract or repel each other as well. And this takes into account the interactions between molecules. And so you can see it's the same variables for the ideal gas equation. We need the number of moles, the gas constant, the temperature in Kelvin, the volume. But we have, and same over here, but we have two constants, and these are called the van der Waals constants, A and B. And these are ones you need either a table or to look up. And so I looked them up. You can find for CO2 in the book, in Jay Mallon's book, but I typically use online resources. Wikipedia has a very extensive list of van der Waal gas constants. And so for CO2, the A constant is 3.64 liter squared bar per mole squared, and the B constant is 0.043 liter per mole. So now it's good to use the gas constant in liter bar per K mole instead of liter atmosphere, which changes it from 0.082 to 0.083, basically, so it's almost the same. So if you use that for the gas constant here, the same number of moles, the temperature volume, and you plug this in, given this new information, let's first leave it as, I tend to solve this part first, and then this part, and then do it afterwards. So when you do that, because both of these are independently pressures, and they actually tell you something interesting at kind of a molecular level about the system. So when you solve for the hard sphere part of it, you're going to get, you know, basically 112 bar. And then minus, when you solve for the attractive component, you'll get 52.6 bar. You know, you get a final pressure of roughly, you know, 59 bars. So what did this tell us? Besides just doing this calculation, the really important point is to get something out of it, to give it some intuition, some physical context to this. Well, the one is telling you that a hard sphere equation of state. And if we compare that, you kind of expect that. These take up molecules, it makes it less compressible. And so the pressure goes up quicker than, for example, an ideal gas. So it's higher. That's exactly what I expected. And it's a little high, you know, it's what, you know, about 10 atmospheres higher. So maybe a little, you know, almost 20. So it's significantly higher than, you know, the ideal gas would be. And then, you know, the other part says that this is attractive in nature, that these CO2 molecules, when made high molar volume or dense, you know, actually attract each other. And so it reduces that hard sphere pressure by 52 bars, by basically half, you know, to give a final pressure for the real gas of 59 bars. So it tells you that, you know, this molecule tends to, when made dense, really attract each other a fair amount. And so it tells you a fair amount about the molecule itself when it behaves more like a real gas. The other thing very significant to this is that you can see it deviates significantly from the ideal gas equation. And this means that you're really under conditions of a real gas, and you should take that into account. And the back of the book uses a solution for an ideal gas, which tends not to be a very good assumption here. So the interesting point is that's part A. So we did a better job, or gave a more realistic pressure that you would expect if you actually experimentally measured it. It would be much closer to basically 59, 60 bars than it would be to, you know, 90 bars or a little higher, et cetera. The other part it asks, though, is now that we've done that, so now in this thing we have, you know, a container that ideally we would say has, you know, roughly around 90 bars pressure in it. And we're going to, you know, we're going to basically, if it has a cap on it, we're going to unscrew that cap and let that gas out, right? And that's basically what it's saying. You're going to let it out against atmospheric pressure, against a one atmosphere pressure. I'm going to erase all this. I thought, there we go. Sorry about that. And quickly look at this component. So, you know, we basically have an opening. We release to the external pressure that we'll assume is one atmosphere, one bar, right? Atmospheric pressure. We have a higher pressure inside, right? With a volume of 30 milliliters, right? And depending on what pressure, but we'll say that this is at, you know, roughly 60 bar pressure, right? And so it, as soon as we open this, the gas is going to escape. And it's asking how much work is done, you know, in this process. So the work, which is path dependent, which is why I put that, you know, it, for mechanical work, you can always, you know, define it as, you know, minus P, the external pressure, dV. Right? This is always case, you know, is always the case. So, and the reason I say that is because you can then make the assumption that the external pressure is the same as the internal pressure, and then apply the equation of state if it's a reversible process. But this clearly wouldn't be, right? Like, you're going to open this thing and it's going to release gas out into the atmosphere, right? That's not a reversible process. You're not going to just rewind that and watch all the gas come back in, right? So we're doing this in a sense, the assumption that's not stated, but the assumption I would make is that this is an irreversible process. So we can just use the external pressure coming off of this. So when we integrate this, the external pressure stays the same. It's a constant, so the integral will go through that, right? And then the overall work, which was path dependent, but we integrated over, is minus the external pressure. And then this is going from the initial volume, which is 30 mils, to whatever the final volume is. So this will just be delta V, or V final minus V initial. And that's shown here. So we know the initial volume is 30 milliliters, or 0.03 liters. What is the final volume? Well, the final volume you basically solve here, You solve it with an ideal gas equation, and here it does make sense to use the ideal gas equation because you're expanding back to one atmosphere, right? So I'm expecting by then CO2 to act very ideally. So when you do that, you find that the overall volume here, so the final volume, which will be, you know, nRT over P, and you have 0.114 moles, you have the gas constant of 0.082 liter atmosphere per mole Kelvin, a temperature of 298, and a pressure, the external pressure of one atmosphere, and when you plug and chug on that, you get 2.79 liters, which is, 2.78 is what they got here, right? And so, you know, that'll give it in units of, if you put this as one atmosphere, will give you units of liter atmosphere, which you can then convert to joules. There's 101 joule per liter atmosphere, and you basically get this as the answer out. So I hope that extended explanation and how we could look at this from a further extension of this and apply a real gas will help you in your understanding of thermodynamics. Thanks.